Hey guys, welcome to the 10th episode of the Impatient Marketer. Today we have with us Hari Ganapati, the co-founder of Pickyourtrail. So Pickyourtrail delivers customized travel itineraries to people for international holidays, right? So good to have you on the show, Hari.
Thanks for your pleasure being here.
Awesome. So why don't you tell us something about yourself? Because for a fact, I know you have traveled, you have crossed the milestone of going to 30 countries by the age of 30. Something that most of us just dream of, right?
So I think I was just fortunate to have had the opportunity to travel, and I think that kind of helped to start Pickyourtrail as well. But quickly, I think, so I hold a BC in physics. I was a non-engineer. And then, like all my life, I think I've done things that are contrarian in some sense. I picked up a non-engineer degree while the world was getting into engineering. And then from there on, I worked with worked as a German interpreter, freelance German interpreter. And that was my first ever brush with the tourism space in some sense, because I kind of took around German tourists and helped them translate, their fortunes and tell them about the, Chola Empire and the Vijayanagara Empire and so on and so forth. And post which I did my MBA from IIM Bangalore. And I think somewhere between, my undergrad and postgrad, I took a keen interest towards people and the way they behave. And so a lot of my coursework around the MBA program was on marketing and consumer behavior and organizational behavior, how people respond, why do people have biases, right? And that's something I was genuinely kicked about. So if you look at, then I moved on with a career in FMCG, worked with Britannia and Reckitt and Benckiser, the makers of Dettol and Harpic. That was a very interesting phase where, I genuinely got to live the dream, of having seen how TV ads were made, right? What it meant to build a brand and understand the overall, strategy behind sales and distribution and how the overall marketing and sales came together. And the entire experience was phenomenal that way. Then InMobi happened. I think InMobi was my first ever brush with the startup. And boy, I think by far the best decision I've made was to kind of pick up that opportunity, because this other point in time was very, very, they had just still not reached that big round and just still pretty much, start. And it was quite a risky. A lot of my friends were working there and they had great things to say about the company. And then I spoke to Navi and phenomenal. I mean, the vision, the kind of way he built the company and what he had in store, right? I mean, I was bowled over by the overall experience. And InMobi was a great turning point in some sense. And I think there's been no looking back from there on. And InMobi kind of served as kind of a foundation pillar for us starting something on our own at Pickyourtrail.
So, like you just said, you previously worked in InMobi and Britannica. But then starting your own travel company is a huge leap, right? It's totally different. So what motivated you to do that?
So I think the way if I look at it, this is a Euro trip. Srinath and I were there. And at the risk of sounding cliched, I think on the Euro trip we figure out that we like travel and there seems to be a problem where people were coming in those buses and then getting dropped off at Notre Dame. And then we were just chilling out, doing our own things. And like, how do you guys manage to do all of this on your own, right? Like, is it easy? How are you going from here to here? And they're like, it seemed quite natural for us. And me and Srinath go back close to about 15, 16 years, right? And we've traveled quite a bit together in India. We've done the green route, which is cutting across three national reserves, right? We've done trips to Dhanushkodi, which is the southern edge. We've done bike trips. So, I mean, travel came naturally to us, and we've kind of traveled together also as people. And on this trip, we figured out that, hey, there seems to be a problem where people are unable to build their own trips to their taste. And this is 2013, right? Way back, about 5-6 years back. And the way we looked at it, to be honest, was, hey, travel is something that we love to do. And worst case, what would happen, right? Worst case would be we would have built relationships in the travel space, right? Which would subsidize our travel. That's the only way we looked at it, right? So worst case, we're getting a discounted trip possibility to travel across the world. And that's the opportunity cost. And we said, okay, we'll take the risk. And the next 5-6 years have kind of panned out, touch wood, quite well for us.
You actually create customized trips, international trips. India is a tourist hotspot as well, right? Like you said, even Dhanushkodi and all that. So why not include India as well?
So it's a very valid question, and we've been asked multiple times, right? And by our own travelers who've gone with us, they want to come back into India. I think our standpoint there has been, so we've done the entire tech play, right? So if you look at a percentage of hotels online in India, right, it's about 33-34%. But Thailand, which is a 2-hour flight from India, has 98% online. So why it matters is, as a brand, right? I mean, if you see in India, a lot of times you also would have experienced, you have a booking, but then when you go there, the booking is not honored, right? It's purely because there are multiple systems, they would not have got confirmations, right? And the experience is subpar, right? Starting there, you look at Uber itself. I don't know if you remember the first days of Uber, phenomenal service, right? The guy would walk down, open the door for you, the cab is clean, right? And whatnot. Now the fares have gone up and the quality has come down. And you have rickety Tata Indicas coming in. And for you, the service quality in India is not really the best out there, right? And the number of properties online, the possibility of doing a tech play, right? All of that is not conducive right now. And when we're at a very early stage of building a brand, right? We want you to be, you know, be associated with a brand that's reliable, that's trustable, right? We didn't want to risk that piece so early on. So we've picked up markets where the reliability and trustability, on-time service, right, cleanliness, professionalism are much, much higher. So that the brand then starts picking up these facets, and over time, the markets also will mature. That will be a good time to come back, and today is the idea we have.
Okay. So you make use of personalization a lot, and almost every travel company that's out there makes use of personalization. What makes you different?
So I think if you look at it for you, let's say as a customer, I mean, I'm no different from Thomas Cook, Sita Travels, Make My Trip, SOTC, right? You are going on a vacation, net, and you want to have a good experience. You personalize, machine learn, artificial intelligence, you don't care any of that. Am I seeing what I want to see at the best possible price? That's what matters for the customer. So if you look at a lot of our messaging, we don't use any of these, you know, ML, AI, those kind of stuff, because for the customer, what matters is trust, right? What customer wants is a good vacation, is a great price, right? A lot of the ways we try and differentiate ourselves from other travel companies. So there are two broad travel companies, right? One is your standard, you know, big daddies like Thomas Cook, Cox and Kings, right? Who have been the traditional way. So they're very clear tech is a differentiator, right? They're still working on, you know, systems where it'll take about 48 hours to get a customized quote, or if you have to change a hotel, it is not always available because they go the contracting way, right? And then there are these new age travel startups, right, which fundamentally as of today, if you see, are only doing itinerary creation. They don't fulfill. The biggies fulfill, but are not completely tech savvy, right? Make My Trip is a clear differentiator. Make My Trip is very, very good in tech. They've acquired companies like MyGola, right? They've invested in other travel companies. So they understand tech. They're doing phenomenal work on the tech side. And I think some of the key differentiators between personally, Make My Trip and Pickyourtrail is the fact that the level of spread, for example, if you go look at Eastern Europe, the number of itineraries you're able to build, the number of routings you're able to create, right? So the sheer depth of availability is significantly different. And that purely becomes is a reason of us focusing only on vacations, while Make My Trip does so many more things than vacations, right? So the amount of depth at which they're able to solve the problem is a function of resources. It's not that they're not possible to do it. Currently, we believe that they're solving much bigger problems in mobile and so on and so forth. And as of today, the product innovation, the number of features that we have, right? We have built alerts, which we launched recently, right? We built a separate flow for Maldives, right? Because we're able to only worry about vacations as a piece, the depth at which we've solved the problem from a consumer perspective is what differentiates us with Make My Trip.
I was also going to your website and then I saw that you actually provide real-time suggestions to people. So if it is weather, if it's cafes, so at what, according to you, is a good customer experience?
So I think these small nudges, right, you spoke about, it starts from that. So a customer experience, when we look at it internally as an organization, we believe it's a culmination of various touch points, right? And these touch points are either physical or digital. Right. So, for example, when you go on the website, you spoke about those little nudges of saying, you know, good time to go, how long is a good time to go. So those are ways we're building trust and thought leadership, saying, hey, these guys seem to know what they're saying. I like the experience. Now, what happens is a vacation, international vacation, especially is a 2.5-3 lakh ticket size, which means you're going to just come, add to cart and book, right? Which means you're going to drop an inquiry and somebody's going to call you. Now you've had a good digital experience. How do we replicate that on the call, right? Which goes back to training the travel consultant, which goes back to exposing the travel consultant, which goes back to providing enough destination knowledge for travel consultant, right? Then that physical touch point then adds to the digital touch point. Hey, not only was the product beautiful, the guy who spoke to me was reassuring. He understood what my needs were and then was able to give something out, right? This is again customer warm. Then you're able to see a customized itinerary, which is suited to your taste in the budget. Hey, this guy was able to understand the product. Let me build something on his own. And the product then lets you change. I mean, but from the time you've spoken, you might have spoken to 3 more friends who've come back and told you to add a night in Prague is better. Then quickly, if you talk to anybody again on the product, you're able to make it 3 nights. That's another wow. Hey, it's giving me control of my vacation. And then when it comes to payment, there's clear payment terms, right? And then the moment you pay, there's an immediate booking on the app. So a lot of these little touch points, right? We're able to give you visa documents online, right? All of this culminate into the overall experience, which is also part of your in-trip. So on-trip, let's say you suddenly want to change an activity or you find the hotel not very clean, how the team responds. Is the same empathy, is the same thought leadership, the same amount of professionalism even delivered there. Those kind of things, I think, we add up and we track our customer happiness scores.
I know it makes sense, right? Even when I was traveling, sometimes you need guidance on the go, usually. And then this is brilliant. I think it's really brilliant.
In fact, a lot of millennials travel with us, right? So what happens is you have flexibility, right? So we have 2 broad income groups, a double income, no kids, right? Kind of people who broadly use the platform to give them cues as to where do you go, right? Help them done, get done. See, because if you look at booking on your own today, right? I mean, flights is one website, hotels is about 3 or 4 websites. Then you have, you know, low cost carriers or trains or buses or car rentals. So people end up doing at least 30, 35 sites. And book in about 10 sites, right? And I think a lot of millennials love the product because they're able to get all of this done on one platform, number one. And the platform still gives them the flexibility, like you said. Right? Last minute, I want to be able to have the afternoon free. And then like the day before or 2 days before, get quick suggestions on what to do and then go and do that. So I think that kind of control that you've built on the product is what I think works on the double income millennial side for us.
So I saw that you make it possible to personalize the entire vacation without hardly any human intervention, right? It's all automated. Most of the things are automated. So when do you think it's about time to start off with automation?
I think, like I said, while a lot of the stuff is automated, we strongly believe it's an emotional purchase. Right? A vacation is not a very transactional purchase, right? So there's a certain amount of human touch that we still need. Right? Because there's a lot of reassurance that's needed. Because it may be the first time you're going to the city, you're unsure if there'll be veg meals on the airline, you're not sure about the visa documents, you might have got married, you don't have a marriage certificate, so you want to know if you can still apply for visa. So a lot of these little chinks, right, of information that you want to be reassured with. Right, so that is where our travel consultant team comes in and tries to build reassurance, right? But ideally, the ideal world is we'd love for you to just come a few clicks and just book and get done with it, right? But I think we're at least a 2-3 year time gap away before the people get comfortable doing an Amazon or Flipkart equivalent on Pickyourtrail.
You guys have this amazing guides. So I'm a huge fan, personally huge fan. Plus you guys, on top of it, have blogs for every single destination telling what people can do, what can they do and all that. How important do you think is content marketing when it comes to travel companies like yours?
I think content marketing is a very double-edged sword in travel, to be honest, right? So you look at it, right? Who are you competing with? You're competing with Lonely Planet. You're competing with Google. Right? And they are like the largest. Lonely Planet has built by far the most trustable travel brand in the world. Right? And your blog is competing with this blog. Right? Or you're competing with Google, which is using AI to our infinity to say, hey, by the time you finish searching, giving you the results. Right? So, I mean, from a pure competition perspective, it's extremely competitive. But I think the way we have taken a stand internally is that we are not trying to compete with Google and Lonely Planet, right? We are trying to see, can my content nudge decision-making? Can my content nudge build trust? right? So what I mean by that is, let's say you're planning your trip to Europe, right? You have a very interesting blog on Schengen visa, right? So that is part of my overall CRM journey, right? From the time the lead signs up, in about 10 days, he gets a content on, hey, Schengen visa, top FAQs, right? Somebody going to Bali, right? Forex is a significant conversation. So we've kind of identified what are all the reassurance points that customers want in the journey and created content around it and used it on the app to build that trust and reassurance. So that's where we've kind of nailed the overall flow.
You have partnered with some of the world's leading tour operators and service providers. What goes behind getting funded? Any tips for the entrepreneurs who are watching this?
Sorry, what goes behind?
What goes behind getting funded? How can
getting funded?
Yeah.
To be honest, I wish we had an easy answer to that question. I think for us, see, we were bootstrapped for about 5.5 years. Right? It's almost about 65 months we were bootstrapped. Right? And we were unit economics positive from day one. Right? And we kind of saw the Indian VC high and the low in the last 5 years. And I think a very, very important aspect to getting funded is clearly understanding, is your model, right? What kind of funding your model requires, right? So something's a very asset heavy or networks driven, right? You need very early funding to kind of build those networks or, you know, build the asset heavy models, right? So that's very clear, yes. So a market like, or a business model like ours, where we're drawing unit economic positive and we're trying to change behavior. Nobody buys 2.5-3 lakh vacations online. It's not a transaction like or a Uber or a Swiggy, where transaction leads to habit. And because there are at least 2 or 3 transaction touch points every day, a vacation is 1 or 2 transaction touch points in a year. Right? Swiggy will have at least 1,000 transaction touch points in a year. Right? So it's very easy to build habits around those so many touch points. So for us, we're very clear that we had to build a viable product. And the product should work for itself before you even wanted to go and raise. Because the moment you raise money, right? I mean, there's a lot of responsibility to make that money work. And making the money work means growing faster, right? In very simple terms, right? So I think one of the key things before getting funded is for you to ask yourself that hard question. Are you in a position that if you imagine yourself, you have so much money in the bank, how will you grow faster? That blueprint should be very clear in your mind. Right? It could be through customer acquisition, it could be through asset acquisition, it could be through a product flywheel that is well established, right? So unless and until you have the clarity, I think it would not be in your best interest to go seek funding.
You have a lot of good ratings and reviews on Facebook. To be specific, you have all 5-star ratings. So what goes behind getting good reviews? Is there a mantra?
So I think the best way to get good reviews is what I tell the team, clean sell. Right? If the clean sell happens, the review is just an outcome. What happens is people, either the product doesn't communicate well, the product kind of is very ambiguous. It says, you know, pickup available, but doesn't tell if it's a hotel pickup or a common meeting point pickup. And then when you are with a kid in a very alien country and suddenly you realize today morning that you have to walk 15 minutes for a pickup, which is 2 hours from now, you're just in a rush, right? How do we avoid these surprises for travelers, right? That's the easiest way to get those reviews, right? Obviously, even after delivering those kind of experiences, you follow up. I mean, people are, it hits them hard. But when they open up their laptop, they have so many 100 emails, they go back to work mode, right? So there is some bit of follow-up here to say, hey, you know what, you had a fab trip. Can you really drop reviews? Because we built the business on the back of reviews, right? I mean, that guy came in or that person came in because he saw good reviews, right? It's just about going in, letting them know that, hey, you had a good experience. Can you help somebody else also discover and make an informed choice?
So you actually saying that follow-ups are essential when it comes to getting reviews.
Yes, I think follow-ups are essential. And the fact that, see, if you look at our product, also there are testimonials which are kind of interspersed across the product, which means there is a subliminal impact where the guy knows that, hey, I have seen some good reviews and hence that helped me make this purchase, right? And then can you also put them on that high pedestal saying, hey, your review could matter to somebody else. Can you help me get that review going? Right? So I think that amount of communication with our travelers really helps get that review.
Perfect. So there are a lot of travel companies right now, a lot. How do you make sure that the customers come back to you every time? How do you retain them?
So I think in when it comes to retention, right, because it's a very emotional purchase, broadly, I think so. For example, let's say if you had to buy your marriage sari, right? I'm sure there are two or three shops either ancestrally people know or you know your friends have recommended and you go there. But then you have to buy a top, you just go randomly and buy anything, right? You're more experimental when you're buying a top, but you're not experimental when you're buying a sari or sherwani, right, for your reception, right? So travel is one such behavior. It's not a very, very, very risky purchase, right? So if a good experience is given, more often than not people come back to you. Right? Because they did their Thailand trip with us, they're very happy, when they're going on the Euro trip with us, they're like, hey, why go experiment? I had a great experience, I'll come back to them. Right? You went on the Thailand trip, you come back from a vacation, everybody's like, wow, how was it? Hey, fab, great. And how did you go? Hey, this company is phenomenal, they let me customize, there's so much, you know, personalization and freedom. I think you should try them on. So repeat and referral continues to be 60% of our business. Right? And because the very sticky purchase, right, delivering very high quality experiences helps us retain and repeat customers.
If I'm not wrong, you actually get a lot of sales through referrals, right? Awesome.
Yes.
So what does your referral plan look like?
To be honest, we don't have one. I think we've been really, really lazy and we don't even have a referral program. I mean, purely on good faith and people have kind of referred us. A referral piece, that's something very clearly and focused this year. I mean, we've been thankful to have had travelers who've kind of referred us without expecting anything in return. And I think this year, very clearly, our focus is to build a phenomenal referral program and give it back to them for all the support they've given us all these years.
Awesome. So, the last question, this is how we end every show with. What are your words of caution for budding entrepreneurs who want to start off with their own travel company?
I think one thing that's helped us, and I kind of pass the message, I don't know if it is wisdom, but I think it's worked for us, is to have your own North Star, right? So what I mean is to be very clear as to why you're doing what you're doing. Right? It's in this age and time, it's very easy to get swayed by what's happening either in the market or especially if you're working in a co-working space. What's the guy next to you doing? What's the guy, you know, sitting in front of you doing? Right? It's very easy to get swayed. I think having that internal North Star saying, why am I doing what I'm doing and where do I want this to be? That conviction really helps and helped us go through, you know, 5 years bootstrapping, you know, why we're doing. We're always clear why we're doing, like why we want to domestic, why we're doing investing in product, why we want to invest in a lot of people, right? Those kind of questions that really helps. So at some point, writing down what is your North Star as an individual and what is your North Star as a company really helps and helps you especially in troubling times.
Thank you so much for taking your time, Hari. A lot of insights.
Hey, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for hosting me. Sorry for the back and forth, but had a lot of fun. Hope you had fun as well.
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye.